make a copy of God's Word, New Testament, in its entirety offered to you freely without any cost and any obligation to you. If you'd like one, do feel free to ask for one, gladly place such into your hands. It is the Word of God. And it means that God has appointed by which men and women could come to know that the Lord is God, that He made heaven and earth, yourself included, and that, of course, He has, by that fact, a rightful claim over your life and existence. The Bible, of course, is necessary. Person cannot come to saving knowledge of God through His Son Jesus Christ, whom He has appointed both Savior and Lord. Without the Bible, it's impossible for a person. The knowledge, you see, is there within the pages. It's God's record, God's testimony with regards to His Son Jesus Christ, and what He has accomplished in order that people such as yourself might be saved from the law of sin and death. But there are some things that are absolutely and totally fundamental to God's salvation. Things that maybe one or two things on the periphery that you could maybe argue and debate about, things, of course, in the Bible, as the Bible itself testifies, that are complex, that are difficult to understand. But, of course, when it comes to the matter of God's salvation, that is, how a person gets into a right status with God, well, then that's quite simple, and it's quite fundamental, too. There are truths, certain truths, of course, that have to be believed in order for a person to be right with God, that is, to be saved. And it's those that, well, that I want to share with you this afternoon. In the Old Testament, for instance, you have these words, O Israel, thou hast destroyed thyself, but in me is thine help. Addressed, of course, to, in the first instance, to God's ancient people, but of similar reference, of course, to, well, everybody in God's creation, even today. O man, you could say, thou hast destroyed thyself, but in me is thine help. Man has destroyed himself. God made man in the beginning. God made man upright, wanting for nothing, a perfect righteousness, and a perfect knowledge of God. That's the image of God in which God made man in the beginning. But of course, as you look around you, and perhaps maybe even examine your own heart this afternoon, well, you wouldn't need to be a rocket scientist to see and understand that that's well nigh gone, if not altogether gone. Who is there amongst you here this afternoon who could testify that you have a perfect righteousness before God? Who is there of you who could see that you have a true knowledge of God? Here you are. I think it would be safe to argue, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it would be safe to argue that most of you, probably 99.9% of you here this afternoon, under the sound of my voice, you don't even know the ABCs of the gospel, let alone have a true knowledge of God. But that's the way it was in the beginning. Everything, you might say, was rosy in the garden. But now not only have the roses faded, they've died and gone. Now everything is not lovely in the garden at all. It is overgrown with weeds. And of course, an enemy has done this through the temptations of the evil one. Man has fallen into, well, what the Bible describes as ruin. Totally and completely ruined. No knowledge of God and unrighteous to a man. Sin, you see, it goes right back to the beginning, to our first parents, yours and mine. Their names were Adam and Eve. They sinned and they brought sin into the world because of them, of course, their sin, which is passed on to us. We're faced with all manner of suffering and, of course, eventually death. The bus up there in the marketplace, if you venture that way, it says on the back of the bus, it says, it's okay to talk about cancer. That may well be, and if you've got it, then, well, you would want to talk about it. But of course, in this day and age, well, it's not okay to talk about sin. A much worse disease than cancer ever was. There's something worse, you see, than dying of cancer. There's something worse even than being caught up in a nuclear holocaust. There's something worse than perishing in an earthquake, and it's perishing in your sin, dying in unbelief. Man's ruin, you see. We and our children, God's testimony, not mine.
It's easy to be a preacher.
Yes, sir?
It's easy to be a preacher.
Is it? You think so? Have a go, sir. We and our children, God's testimony is this, his indictment. We and our children are conceived and born in sin, and therefore are children of wrath. Man's ruin. Man's ruin, you see. We've ruined ourselves. Oh man, thou hast ruined thyself, destroyed thyself, and that is with sin. Man's ruin, man's sin, of course, and the result of it is that now, of course, we are not only conceived, but we are born in sin. A sinner, before you even speak your first word, before you think your first thought, before you've taken any action whatsoever, in fact, before you left your mother's womb, you are a sinner, a monster, you might say, in the eyes of the Almighty. Because right then when you are being conceived, you are conceived, God says, in sin. And that's why, you see, maybe perhaps you've pondered in a quieter moment as to why you do some of the things that you do, even though you know them to be not right. Things that you know that you ought not to do, but still you do them. You perhaps stifle your conscience.
Thanks for your birth.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. God bless you. You know, in a quieter moment, you think, you reflect, and you think, well, why did I do what I did? I know it was wrong. I keep on doing it, so help me. It's like I can't help myself, you know. Doesn't matter what the sin is, you know, ingrained in us, you know, or maybe the occasional sin, but why, ask yourself the question, why do we do these things? Why don't we just do what's right? Everybody, you know, I hear people saying, we all just need to love one another. Well, okay, but why don't we? Huh? Why don't we? Some people, they tell me, you know, they don't believe in anything they can't see, so they won't believe in God. Well, that means you don't believe in love. Huh? That means you don't believe in love. You don't believe in logic. Huh? You see, friends, it's nonsense, utter nonsense. You know that God is. You have a conscience that bears witness, testifies with me here this afternoon. The word conscience means with knowledge. Knowledge of what's right and what's wrong. And your conscience bears testimony with me that you have sinned, that you have done wrong. Because when you do wrong, your conscience troubles you. When you do right, it pats you on the head and says, well done. So you see, friends, we are ruined to a man, to a woman. None of us have escaped. The disease has been passed on down through the generations. We're conceived, we and our children, conceived and born in sin, and therefore children of wrath. It's our nature. We're born that way, born in sin. So you quite naturally sin. How can you bring a clean thing out of an unclean? That's impossible. Well, how can you bring clean children out of unclean parents? This too is impossible. But you, that is. But don't you see, friends, it's the nature. It's the nature of the beast in you. You know, the beast of sin. It's in all of us. That's why we don't all just love one another. That's why we don't get it right, and we'll never get it right. No matter how hard you try, and isn't it true, the harder you try, the worse it gets? Because you got a nature in you, you know, that's sinful. You know, and that's where it comes from. You just quite naturally do that which is contrary to God. We're born ungodly, contrary to God in our natures, and so therefore contrary to God in our practice. We're rude. But the good news, that's the bad news, but the good news is that God has given us a remedy, you know? And you read the Old Testament and all down through that history, the plan of God, you know? The coming of His Son, the proclamation, the prophesying, the declaring. Hello, how are you? Good. Enjoy your drink. You know, the preparation, if you like, you know, of the coming of the Son of God. Here's food for your faith. If you think, consider about it, you know. Who can tell the end from the beginning? You can't. Oh, I know there are some people who claim they can. You go to Gypsy Rose Lee, she'll tell you the future. I remember walking past one of her caravans one day, and there was a sign on the door. It said, sorry, closed due to unforeseen circumstances. Yeah. No, you can't. You don't know the end from the beginning. You don't know the future. But God, there in the Old Testament, He has declared the end from the beginning. And all down through those years of history, God was declaring the sending of His Son, Jesus Christ, into the world. And what He would do and why He would do it. And friends, the New Testament, the Bible, is the fulfillment of all those things that were prophesied that came to pass. In the Old Testament, God does, He draws a picture, if you like. In the book of Isaiah, He draws a picture of the cross of Jesus Christ, and He does everything but put the name Jesus over the cross. So clear, so distinct was that prediction. And just as God declared it would be so, so it came to pass. God's plan of redemption. In fact, it goes back even beyond the history of the Old Testament. Before the foundation of the world, God planned these things. His plan of redemption. The answer to man's ruin, God's remedy. His Son, Jesus Christ, sent into the world to be the Savior of the world. And it's our place here this afternoon to be able to tell you this good news, that salvation has been accomplished. Everything has been done necessary for man's salvation, to undo that ruin, to bring you back to God, to restore you to a perfect righteousness in God's Son Jesus Christ, to restore you to the knowledge of God that is completely and totally erased from your minds, from your soul. Righteousness is God, friends. Not by anything that you or I do. Not by being religious, but faith, but by trusting, believing, taking God at His word, believing in God's plan of redemption, what God has accomplished in His Son, Jesus Christ. Resting in the righteousness of another, because yours and mine is no good. because yours and mine is ruined, because yours and mine is, you know, totally unacceptable to God. Only the righteousness of another. And here's the problem, you see, in that day when God judges, and he will, the entire human race in righteousness, unless you're found trusting in the righteousness of another, even Jesus Christ. Friends, you're lost, and you're lost forever. So you see, friends, you need righteousness, but you need the righteousness of somebody else. You need a perfect righteousness, and that can only be found in Jesus Christ, because he and he alone lived that spotless, blameless life, the life that qualified him for the cross to pay the penalty that was due to the sins of man. And friends, that has all been accomplished. Jesus Christ has paid the price in full. Jesus Christ died the death that was due to you and I. The death that we should have died, he died. He took the penalty, made of a woman, made under the law, and paid the penalty of the law, for the wages of sin is death. Here you are today, you live under the threat, you know, the spiritual death. You're separated from God now as a result of your iniquity, your ruin. But of course, the day is coming. The day's coming when you're going to die physically. Well, why? Why can't that be overcome? Why is the bus up there in the marketplace talking about cancer? Because people are dying of cancer all the time. People are dying of other things, young people and old alike. Why? If you're not a sinner, if you've never sinned, if you've never broken God's law, then friends, you're not going to die. You cannot die. But that's the only way you'll ever prove that you're not a sinner, is by not dying. But we all die. For why? Because of the sin factor, man's ruin. It is appointed unto man once to die. It's a divine appointment. It's the wages of sin. Not just spiritual death, but physical. And then, of course, well, if you're not saved, if you're not delivered, if you're not restored to the favor of God, then you die eternally. So, you see, friends, it's sin's wages. It's the payback, you know. You say, well, okay, I get that, but I'm not bothered, I don't care. I just want to live my life. Just want to do as I please, you know, do my own thing. Carry on living in my sin. Okay, but just remember, there's a payback, there's a day coming, there's a divine appointment. You're going to stand before God, and you're going to stand before the God that you always knew existed. You know? Don't tell me that you don't know that there is a God. Don't tell me that you don't believe in God. Yeah? Every man, woman, and child born into this world knows that God is. And I mean the living and true God. I mean the God of the Bible. I mean the God and Father of my Lord Jesus Christ. I'm not talking about the God of gods of heathen religion. I'm not talking about the gods of your cults and sects. I'm talking about the living and true God. Everybody, man, woman, and child, born into this world, knows that God is. So what's the problem? Well, you got a problem with God. That's the problem. And you know that. So what do? Instead of acknowledging God, instead of crying out to God, instead of getting right with God, you suppress that truth in unrighteousness. You don't want there to be a God, and you can't find God for the same reason a thief can't find a policeman. You don't want to find them. Because you know you're on the wrong side of them. You know he's not well pleased with you. So you just hold the truth in unrighteousness, in wickedness, in unbelief. You suppress that truth. For friends, this redemption, God's remedy has been accomplished. His Son has come just as God said he would, and he's died and rose again from the dead in order that men and women might have eternal life, might be restored to the knowledge of God, the righteousness of God, a perfect righteousness of God. is presented to you in the gospel, in the good news of his son Jesus Christ. But of course this remedy has to be applied. It's not good you knowing about it. It's not good you having the knowledge. You can have all the knowledge about the Bible, about religion that a man could possibly have. But friends, knowing something and doing something about it is something else. The Bible says elsewhere, you know, about being doers of the Word of God and not just hearers. Or you can hear, you can acknowledge, you can nod your head, and maybe you can maybe even mutter an amen under your breath. But have you done something about it? Have you applied the remedy to yourself? Have you applied the truth to yourself? And God says that all sin that comes short of the glory of God, that means you too. That includes you. When he says there's none righteous, that's you. When he says that all are separated as a result of their iniquities from him, that includes you too. That truth has to be applied to you. And friends, of course, so too does the remedy. When God says, if you believe, if God says, if you turn, if God says, if you repent, if you turn from your wicked deeds, if you bring an end of your suppression of the truth and unrighteousness and turn to God in the way of repentance and faith, seek ye the Lord while he may be found, call ye upon him while he is near, has to be done in faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. It has to be applied. The remedy, you see, has been planned, accomplished, but it must needs be applied. Because, friends, all the knowledge in the world will not save you until you apply it to yourself directly and powerfully through faith in the Son of God, even Jesus Christ our Lord, whom we declare to you today. So how? You might ask, how? How do I apply it? Well, you use the Word of God given to you, the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation. The Word of God is given to instruct you, to teach you, that is, to reprove you, correct you, and to instruct you in the way of righteousness. You take to the Word of God and you get yourself informed. And you apply the Word of God written, that is, you apply it to yourself, to your own heart and condition. And you cry out to God. You do what he tells you to do. No one, I tell you, whether you be a Christian or not, no one who has ever picked up the Bible and sought to obey it, to do what God tells them to do, has ever been a loser. Friends, the Word of God, and especially so the proclamation of the Word of God, is especially the means by which God has ordained that souls might be saved. How are you doing, kid? Why are you not at school? Why are you not at school?
Skiving.
Yeah. Oh man, that's wicked. That's sinful.
No,
I don't believe it. I don't believe it.
Tell me. We've had a half day.
I know. Oh, see, you just told a lie. You just told a lie.
And God, that's another sin.
God, that's another sin. That's right.
All right.
You need to listen to your buddy. Yeah. And to me. Yeah. You need to repent of your sin and believe on Jesus Christ that you might be forgiven for your wicked lie. What?
Who's that?
Who's what?
Jesus Christ.
Who's Jesus Christ? You don't know?
No.
You haven't been taught nothing?
No.
Well, they teach you this in school?
No.
Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the Son of God. The God that you know exists. The God who made you and gave you life and being. And the God who one day is going to judge you for telling lies.
Who's that?
God.
Who's that?
Who made you.
Do you know him as a person?
Yes.
Do you?
Yes.
No.
So do you.
No, I don't.
So do you. So do you.
Is his name
no? You have more sins.
You know what you say?
No, I believe in God.
Do you?
What's his last name?
I haven't got a last name. God will do.
That's weird, that is.
God's
no,
God.
I'm dead confused now.
No. It's you who are weird.
How am I weird?
You're weird because you see, because you're not right with God. Because you're not right with God. That's why you're impudent. That's why you're cheeky. That's why you're asking me these questions in a mocking tone.
Hold
and
on.
God God will hold you to account for that too. I think you need to walk on, boy, because you're just making it worse. You're digging yourself a hole out of which you can't get yourself. Only Jesus can get you out of it.
Yeah? I'm sorry, sir.
That's all right. Don't worry. Bye, not your sir. Fault. Have a good day, boys. Enjoy your holidays. Enjoy your holidays.
Here we go. What? And you talk to children like that.
Like what? We were having a nice conversation till you came along. Go away, nasty woman. We were having a nice conversation till you came along, woman. Where was I? Oh yes. The Word of God is given to us, you see, in order, you know, that we might be saved. You see, it's a book, not a book about religion. You know, get that notion, please get that notion out of your head, you know. The thread that weaves its way all through the Bible is the person of God's Son, Jesus Christ, who would come, who would be sent into the world, who came, lived and died, and rose again from the dead. And friends, religion is... the distinction between the religion and the gospel is this. You know, religion is about what men do. You go to religion, any one of your world religions you care to name, Islam, Roman Catholicism, Buddhism, Confucianism, and all the rest of them. There's only two religions in the whole world. There's God's religion, and there's the devil's religion. And the devil has a multitude of expressions of his religion. And that's all your world religions. And they all tell you the same thing, that you got to do something. You got to do something to get God's favor, you know? You got to work in order to get the favor of God. But the good news of the gospel, friends, is this, that you don't have to work, that you cannot work, because it's of grace. And if it's of grace, the grace of God, the gift of God, then it's not of works. It can't be both. It's either one or the other. If it's of works, then work. But it's not. But here's the question. How much work have you got to do? How religious do you have to be in order to get right with God? Friends, you see, it's infinite. It's unanswerable. But here's the good news, friends. The gospel, the grace of God in Jesus Christ is... It's all been done. The work has been done for you. It's been done by another. It's been done by Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He came and he lived and died. He paid the penalty. He paid the price. He did what we couldn't do. He said, I have the power to lay down my life and take it again. Because no one ever said that before, and no one has ever said it since. No man can do that. Only God himself. And he laid down his life and took it again. Rose again from the dead by his own almighty power. He's done. That's the work. That's the work of God. And the work of God for you is something only this, that you believe. Faith that you rest in the work, in the person of Jesus and in his work. That alone gets you the favor of God, nothing else. Because there ain't nothing you can do that will bring pleasure to God, that will please God, nothing at all. Because all you are, every one of us, we're just lumps of walking, breathing, talking sin. That's all we are. So everything and anything that we would offer to God is tainted with sin, is vile, you know, it's vile, monstrous in the eyes of God, repugnant, disgusting even, vile. But friends, the sacrifice of his own Son, Jesus Christ, that was a perfect sacrifice. That was a sweet aroma to God, well-pleasing to God. And the person, the man or woman who puts their trust in the person and work of Jesus is a person who is pleasurable to God also. It's God's remedy for man's ruin. So calling upon the name of the Lord, you see, the Word of God in prayer, these are the means that God has appointed. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Saved from sin's penalty. Calling upon the communicating with God, praying, you know. Oh, you see, I never prayed in my life. I wouldn't even know where to begin. What about God be merciful to me, a sinner? That would be a good place to begin. And cry, and give him no rest until he comes to you, until you know that you've been forgiven, until you know that you have eternal life, until you know that you have been born again, until you know that you have God smile upon you. Call upon the name of the Lord, and you shall be saved, is God's promise. Saved from the penalty, the wages of sin, always has been and always will be to the end. Only one answer to death, and that's life. Of course, it's sin. Sin is the cause. But of course, you know, we're always wanting to treat the effects, aren't we, you know? Oh, we want rid of these horrible effects, you know? All these things that make me miserable, you know? I want rid of them. How can I deal with the effects, you see? You know? Instead of going to the root of the problem, you know? Like the bus up in the marketplace again. How can I deal with cancer, you know? Go to the root of the matter, right to the very depth of man's being, his ruin and sin, because instead of that pit, instead of that fountain, sin, man's ruin, comes all the suffering, all the disease, all the misery, all the pain, and all the death that man has to face. That's where it comes from. And I tell you, until you deal with the cause, the effects are not going to go away. You just keep ignoring the cause and treating the effects. And it just doesn't work. Temporarily, maybe, but not for good. But God has given you a remedy. God has given you the good remedy. God has given you the everlasting remedy. Eternal life in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Everlasting love. Everlasting kindness, everlasting joy, everlasting peace God has pronounced for all those who will apply the remedy, that is, turn from their sin, from their wicked ways, and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, they will be saved. You see, when God's remedy is applied, well, you see, it ends in man's redemption. A heart transformed, not just the outside. See, going back to religion again. Religion will change you on the outside. Change the way you dress, perhaps, maybe. Put a burqa on your head, you know. Or maybe some fancy frock to wear, you know. It'll change you on the outside, but it won't change you on the inside. Because religion doesn't get down into the vitals of man's soul. It's only the gospel that does that. It addresses the heart, and that's why so many of you hate it. That's why so many of you get into a rage over it, like yon woman. Anything but the truth. Hate the truth of the condition of your own heart. You know? But that's why you hate it. That's why you don't want it. That's why you reject it. Because it goes to the heart of the matter. But until the heart's changed, until the heart's mended, friends, you're going nowhere. You're going nowhere as far as God's concerned. But God's redemption, God's remedy, applied to man, you see, the transformation of the heart, the innermost being. A man's born again, as Jesus puts it. And now he has a love for God instead of a hatred for God. And now he has a hatred for sin instead of a love for sin. You love the things you once hated and hate the things that you once loved. Everything's turned around, thrown into reverse thrust. No longer living for and the enjoyment of sin, but living for God and for His glory. A heart aflame with love for God, for your Maker. Going back to the way that God first made man in His own image, that image restored. A perfect righteousness and a proper knowledge of God. That's God's plan of redemption. And that's what takes place when a man, when a woman applies it to him or to herself. The heart changed. The heart aflame with love. And not just for God, but for your neighbor too. Able, like you never could before, to fulfill God's law, summed up by Jesus, love for God and love for your neighbor. But no one ever loved God. No one ever loved their neighbor until they loved God. That's why we keep destroying one another. That's why we keep destroying our country. That's why we keep destroying our families. That's why we keep destroying our homes. That's why we keep destroying ourselves. Oh man, thou hast destroyed thyself, says God. With sin. With sin. So friends, God's remedy, a heart change, a heart and a life transformed, not just the heart, but the life, the practice too. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. It begins with the inner life, the thought life, the heart, the mind. That changes and the way changes, the practice changes. That's the transformation that comes by the gospel, and a change of status before God, declared not to be unrighteous but to be righteous, perfectly righteous. No, not practically righteous, perfectly righteous, friends, declared a legal righteousness. An ungodly sinner, God, the minute a sinner believes, truly believes on Jesus, God dons the judge's cap and the gavel comes down and he makes the declaration, justified, not just not guilty, justified, righteous in the sight of God. It's a declaration by the Almighty that can never be reversed, can never be changed. No condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. On that day when God judges the world in righteousness, those who have believed, those who have trusted, those who have applied God's remedy to their hearts and lives, on that day, no condemnation, never ever again. No shadows between you and God, nothing but the immense blue of his infinite ocean of loving kindness. For those that is who turn, for those who turn from their ruin, for those who turn from their sin, turn from their wicked ways, turn from their unbelief, turn from their suppression of the truth, and turn to God through his Son Jesus Christ and believe on his name. No condemnation, a change of status before God, legally righteous before God. But without that faith in God's Son, Jesus Christ, you remain condemned. You remain as you are condemned. Oh, don't condemn me. Don't judge me, people say. Friends, I don't judge you. I don't have to judge you. I don't condemn you. I don't have to condemn you. Jesus said on one occasion, he said, I did not come to condemn. I came to save men, he said. God doesn't have to condemn you. We're already condemned. He that believeth on him, Jesus that is not condemned. But he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Already condemned to a man, to a woman. Every single man, woman, and child born into this world, we and our children are conceived and born in sin, and therefore children of wrath, and remain that way and go out of this world that way unless there is a change of cataclysmic proportions. That is, unless you have been born again of the Spirit of God, given a new nature, a new heart, a new life, unless that is, you have repented, turned from your sin, and believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, you remain under the condemnation of God. But friends, that condemnation can be lifted. It can be lifted off from you even this very day. There is compassion, there is mercy with God. This is the heart of the gospel, that there is forgiveness with God, that he may be feared. Forgiveness, compassion, kindness, mercy for the worst of sinners. I don't care how dark and how dirty, how dangerous your sins might be, or however long you've been at it. Friends, there is forgiveness with God. There is a way back to God from sin's dark path, and that way is Jesus Christ.
So we can do anything we want?
No. No. No.
Well, shut up then.
No. You shut up. Go away, sir. Go away. Like I say, no, don't go away. Stand there and listen. Stand there and listen. However dark and however dirty, however dangerous your sins might be, we love you, sir. We love you, sir. We love your soul, sir. Repent and believe the gospel, sir. We love you, though you revile us. We love you, sir. Repent, sir. Believe the gospel, sir. You know it's true, sir. That's why you're enraged. You're convicted. Your conscience troubles you. Like I say, friends, you know, however long you've been at it, your sin, I mean, there's a way back to God. And Jesus says, I am that way. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Neither is there salvation any other name under heaven given amongst men by which we must be saved. Jesus, that's his name. You got the name right, kid. You got the name right. Remember it. Jesus is his name. And salvation is to be found in that name. And no other name under heaven by which you must be saved. Turn to him today. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. God's command with the promise. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him turn to the Lord, and he will show mercy, abundantly pardon. Turn to him today. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the wise thing to do. Man's ruined. Man's own ruin. Ruined yourself, says God. Ruined. Ruined yourself, O man. But your remedy in me, says God, in me is your help. God will help you. Call upon his name today. Call upon him while he is near. Friends, you would like a copy of God's word? Check these things out for yourself. See that they are so in accordance.
Doesn't the Bible specifically state not to preach?
No, it says to preach.
No, it says
you got it wrong. You got it wrong. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Matthew 28. Check it out. Check it out. Command of Jesus. What, sir? Come and talk to me, sir. Come and talk to me, sir. We don't like drive-by hecklers. Come and talk to me. Say something, sir. Like I say, it's the word of God. It's offered to you freely. New Testament in its entirety. You'd like one. Do feel free to come and ask for one. Gladly place it into your hands. May God bless you and have mercy upon your precious, precious, never dying soul. Oh yes, oh yes. We've do you want it on? Do you want
it on? No,
sorry. Okay, right. Have you right? Okay. Okay, that's good. Okay, okay. Have a nice day. Have a nice day. Yeah, yeah. Well, it's obviously getting to them.
Huh? Dry bones.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah. Without this cage. He listened for quite a time before he before he gave expression.
I'm trying to get his eye contact to see where he was, but he wouldn't look at me.
For or against?
And you know, that's everybody. I'll sit down there, nobody would get eye contact. All the way through, not one. Nobody would take it.
No, and that this chap sitting to the right, he's been back 2 or 3 weeks. He sat there, yeah, 2 or 3 occasions. He's come and sat there just towards the end, like, you know. So that may just be coincidence, but